Thank you. Thank you for the introduction. So I'm coming from this Spanish Pulse Laser Center. So in this community, when you heard the, when you listen the word laser, you immediately start to think on that. So you irradiate with a laser a test device when you maybe, I mean, you simulate some single event effect on the electronic that you want to test. So the main goal of this very short introduction presentation is to change this idea. When you listen the the word laser, you're also going to think it's something else. This something else what we are going to talk about, and this is acceleration. So what this talk is about, particle acceleration based on laser produced plasma. So the idea is to focalize the laser, not in the test device, but in a material, what we call the target. And here we produce a particles beam. So here is produced electron beams, photon beams, also proton ions beams, neutrons. So there is a large, I mean, there is many species of particles they are produced that can maybe can be used for tests in electronics for this community. Okay, so maybe an expert in laser plasma will say that this is not very correct, this way to define the particle accelerator based on laser plasma, but I will just reduce to say that with the laser we are capable to produce a very huge electric fields, so huge like this one, so it's not working. Okay, so with this voltage that no other accelerator is capable to produce right now, we are able, for instance, to accelerate electrons to this in energy for GeV in a very short distance. So this is the accelerator, 9 centimeters, and we get a beam of 4 GeV with a petabat laser. That was done with the Vela laser in Berkeley, and I have to stress also here that the laser that we have at CPU is a brother of this one. So it's the same technology on the same capability. So the so-called, so this amazing feature, the so-called laser plasma accelerator have many applications, or probably will have many applications for medical and also industry application. For instance, here for the spare application. So I also want to stress that particle acceleration based on laser can operate in many different regimens. It depends on the target, of the plasma that is generated. So when you say it, I'm going to work, or we have a laser plasma, so it's no information at all. So you have to really give more things. On those things, I'm going to really give a very briefly explanation the key parameters that are relevant for this acceleration. The first one is the intensity of the laser. We speak about watt per square centimeter. Okay, and also the material that we put there. So those are the both elements that we need to have. So the target density is very key question here. So there are two kinds of accelerator, if you want to say it that way. One that work with over-dense plasma, and the other one with work with under-dense plasma. We are going to concentrate only this one. Okay. But let's start with the intensity. Why we are capable now to accelerate particles? Because we have huge intensity. The state of the art of the laser are really huge. The evolution in the time scale started here. What is called the CPR, I mean the huge rise of this intensity of the lasers. Around 1985, with this technical CPR, chirped-pulse amplification, I am not going to explain that, but we are capable to get right now what you have seen, something like 10 to the 22 watts per square centimeter. So in blue, you see the energies of the electrons that are going to be produced. So we are right now in the GeV region. It's expected to be really huge in a few years. And what I want to stress here also is that those, the CPA technical technology, is based on pulse emission. So the laser are pulsed. And we are speaking about really short pulses. Okay, this is the map of the laser intensity worldwide. So they are something like less than 100 right now that can reach power more than terawatt. I mean, maybe 0.5 petawatt or 1 petawatt. We are the CLPU. This is the only one, so it's the national facility with a petawatt laser in the country. And this is an schematic view of the laser that is in the CLPU, what we call the Vega laser. It has three different outputs. One with 20 terawatt, the other one with 200 terawatt, and the last one, what we call Vega 3, with 1 petawatt. So the amplification is going gradually. So we start with a very low energy. We start to gain energy. And the main feature of those outputs are that, for instance, the 200 terawatt, we have 6 joules and 30 femtosecond at the repetition rate of 10 hertz. At the petawatt 11, we have the same energy, 30 joules, 30 femtosecond, at the repetition rate of 1 hertz. This is the state of the art of this technology. 1 hertz repetition rate for a petawatt. So as you saw before, so is the technology is still growing. So it expected that it's going to be more in the near future. But right now, we are here. So this is what it looks like, the petawatt laser in Salamanca. So it's something like, I don't know, maybe something like 20 meters long. And here we have the three phases, the terawatt and the petawatt. So this is also a picture, a photograph of the current state of the facility. So here, those are the last phases of the amplification. What inside this chamber we have the compressors. I mean the gratings for the CP in order to amplify with the CPA technology. The one here, the small one, is for the 200 terawatt, and this one is the petawatt. Here is the target area. So the laser, after the compression, just goes through this, the last wall that is there, and come to this area, shielded, and here is the chamber where we focalize the laser, and we get acceleration of the particles. So this is just to have an order of magnitude of the dimension of the chamber. For the gratings, those are the gratings, the diffraction gratings for the CPL technology, technical. And yes, I'm going to speak, as I said, about overdense plasma solid. So we have this parameter. The other one is, so first question, how similar will be the particle beam to those for the space? This is the first question for this community, I think. So the space radiation is really complex. You know better than me. There are many particles, different particles, with a very broad spread of energy range. So, for instance, those energies at very high protons, at very high energies, are not going to be, at this moment, achieved with a laser, but it will come in the future. So what we have is a mixed radiation field with electrons, protons, ions, photons, and neutrons in the space. And this is also what we are able to produce with the laser. And we are going to speak today only about the trapped particles. Okay. What about the electron trapped particles environment? So in this referent, I found this picture with the different, this one is better. So for these different orbitals, so this is how it looks like the spectra. you all know that you can get this for different simulation tools like SPMBIS and so on. And you get electrons lower than 10 MeV energy range. The spectra is continuous. So what we are able to produce is this spectra. That was a real measure. Actually, it was really done long ago. When we have also a very broad band energy of this spectra of electrons. Okay. This spectra is characterized, this follow a Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution and is characterized by a temperature. In this case, this is 2 MeV. So we have large energy broadband that could be match the spectra that we have in the trapper radiation bed. And we are also able to produce electrons with very low energies that could be also relevant for studies of the charging. So this is a scaling law. The dots are real experimental data. The curves are laws from different models. You have the other reference. So as I said, one of the parameters of more interest is intensity, what is called the E lambda square. When we increase the intensity, of course, we are going to have more temperature of this distribution of electrons. So in the previous slide, we can change the let's say the level of this curve. So we can match maybe for different orbits the level of the fluxes that we have with the same energy range. Okay. So how similar would be? So those are real experiments made by Hidin et al. Very recently, a few years ago. They really match the expected electron emission for a GPH orbit with a measurement with a laser plasma accelerator. The temperature here is 0.6 MeV. What about protons? So you can get the simulation of the expected spectra of the protons for the different orbit, again, and those are the measurement of the spectra that we get with a laser. So up to now, the state of the art is that the proton energy that can be reached is 100 MeV. This is the highest. So it's still relevant for this community, this kind of energy. And of course, there is also an scaling for the power of the laser of the maximum energy of the proton that we can get. As I say, the maximum is right now is around 100, and also it depends a lot of the timing of the pulse of the laser. As you see, the different curves, they have different timing. Okay. So we see how similar could be. Let's say how different could be the particulate beam that we get from the target and what is in the space. The radiation field is pulsed, what we get from the target, because it's produced by the laser, and we have a pulsed laser. So we get a bunch of particles. That's what we get in the beam. In the scale, temporal scale of 100 femtoseconds. So here the key point is the timing. We are speaking about femtosecond. With femtosecond, we get this very high intensity, but we are going to get very high fluxes, so huge fluxes. Is this an advantage or a disadvantage for this community or for the other application that the laser will meet? So like everything in life, that has both things. So it's an advantage because we have enough particles to reproduce the space exposition in a very short time. Maybe we can reproduce 1 year of orbit in few hours of exposition. Of course, it depends of the particular case. But it has a very disadvantage that there are non-linear effect might occur because of these very high fluxes. So of course the flux can be reduced. So you just go far away from the source, or you put some shielded in between, and you can reduce the flux. But then the penalty is the increasing of the exposition time. You really need more exposition to get the the dose that you want to have. And also, another disadvantage is that the experimental characterization of the radiation beam is not trivial at all. This is one thing that the community, or for this community, is facing for many years. And here, just to close, the conclusion of this brief exposition. So laser drive search might cover the needs of affordable and compact accelerators for application in the space industry. So first studies are very promising, but still there is a lack of knowledge about the effects that a bunch of particles in a very short time scale might produce. So further studies are needed in order to validate the laser driving source for this application and others. And the last one is that at the CLPU, we are ready to start and to contribute to this field also with the community. Thank you very much for your attention.